Good morning, everyone. My name is Daisy Vasquez, and I'm a member of the Women's Health Symposium Planning Committee, and it is my pleasure to introduce the next panel, or at least the moderator for the next panel. It is Mai Lan Tran, the licensed clinical social worker for Lantern Lupus Asian Network, and she will be introducing the panel for our next topic, which is a woman's health across a lifespan.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. We are shifting from healthcare policy to human stories, women's stories. And my name is Mai Lan Tran. I'm a program manager at the Lupus Asian Network at Hospital for Special Surgery here in town. And it's my great honor to be among this wonderful group of speakers and wonderful group of women here. At this segment is called A Woman's Health Across a Lifespan. Lupus is a chronic disease much more common in Asian American women than in the general population. Osteoporosis is more common in women. An average woman loses 30% of her bone mass between the ages of 45 and 75. And of course, menopause, a natural occurrence in a woman's life, it marks the end of fertility and another chapter, a major health transition in life. So let me turn the table over to our very first speaker, Cindy Manhu. She's a patient and a physician. She's currently a infectious disease fellow at the Kennedy Memorial Hospital, University of Medicine and Dentistry of New Jersey in Stratford, New Jersey.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for inviting me today for the conference organizers, and also thank you because Mai Lan is actually originally gave me the phone call to see if I might have some time today. So, as Mai Lan stated, I'm Cindy Ho. And I came up from New Jersey, good old New Jersey, this morning. So bright and early, I got up at 5:30. But I did it because today I wanted to share with you a special story integrated into some special topics. And just out of curiosity, could you raise your hands if you've even heard of the disease lupus? Okay, great. Fantastic. Okay. Second question might be a little trickier. How many people have heard of the group, the Lupus Asian Network, which stands for Lantern? Okay, well, today's your day. Fantastic. So I do work at a small hospital system in New Jersey, and also in my spare time, I've been on the advisory board for the Lupus Asian Network, which is Lantern, which is a group affiliated with the Hospital for Special Surgery. So this is actually one of our brochures, which you can find on our small table over on the left-hand side, which Eliza was manning prior to the conference beginning. But this is a segment, if you want the prettier actual brochure, that's actually to the left. But what you should know is that lupus is actually an Asian American women's health issue, or it should be considered as such, because the truth is that it is actually much more common in Asian women, 2 to 4 times more common than even in Caucasians. And as Mai Lan stated, it is a chronic disease. It's also an autoimmune disease where, unfortunately, the body attacks your own good cells. And the mysterious thing about lupus, and I understand there are perhaps some medical students in the audience, but it's mysterious because the thing is that it's a disease which can really affect any part of the body. There are some classic symptoms, of course. There's the arthritis, the butterfly rash, the overwhelming sense of fatigue. And now the thing is, with every organ system, it can be affected. I'm using infected because I'm an infectious disease fellow, so speaking along those lines. But some of the organ systems that would be more serious would be your kidneys, your heart, or your lungs. And so today I'd like to talk a little bit about lupus, interwoven into a story. Now, if you would like to know a little bit more about Lantern, you can go to the Hospital for Special Surgery's website. So, by chronic, I mean that this is a disease that one has all of your life. However, if you have any disease, lupus or whatever it may be, what you really need to understand is that diseases can be controlled with medications, physicians, a good support system, family, friends, and more. Now, the caveat is that not everyone with lupus experiences the same symptoms. And in fact, there are actually different forms of lupus. The most serious kind is that which is systemic. And often, kind of, if you throw out the word lupus, most people are referring to the systemic lupus erythematosus, which is abbreviated SLE. So, as I said, lupus is very dear to my heart. I was actually diagnosed at the age of 7 in 1981. And I have this picture by the beach, not because it was a nice day, but because that was actually the summer just prior to when I was diagnosed. And so, just then, in that fall, I believe, I started to have these fevers that no one could really understand where they're coming from. And I actually developed a rash that actually appeared over my face. And I actually had to go to the hospital where they found that my urine was just totally abnormal. And in fact, I needed to be transferred to another hospital, which was affiliated at that time with Penn State, which was in Hershey Medical Center. So there, they did a kidney biopsy. And with a kidney biopsy, basically, they take a tissue behind your back to get your kidney sample. And unfortunately, what it showed is that my lupus had impacted my kidneys. And additionally, they had done other blood tests. So for the med students, you know, the positive anti-nuclear antibody was positive. And for lupus, there are many different types of medications, but kind of the general categories that I'll speak of are, for example, for a very long time, actually, I was on steroids. And steroids are not benign, meaning they have many side effects, particularly if you're on them for a super long time, as I was. So it caused weight gain. And you can see the kind of the puffy cheeks there. The puffy cheeks right here is just because I'm a little chubby. But it also caused me to kind of have not as good of a growth spurt as I would have liked. And also, I was also on a lot of immunosuppressants, which were just these pills by mouth. But immunosuppressants was because, if you can imagine lupus as a disease where your immune system goes badly, the immunosuppressants are medicines designed to calm down that inflammation. So there was a while for a couple of years where I was at Hershey Medical Center, and it was actually my mother who felt that things kind of were just status quo, but she wasn't really happy with that. And when I look back, I have to think that I really have to credit, especially my mother, but, you know, in addition, both of my parents, because it takes a lot of thinking and a lot of courage, I think, to think that, well, here my doctor is treating my daughter, but things aren't necessarily getting better. So she actually did a ton of research and went out there and actually found that there was an experimental research trial going on at the National Institutes of Health, which is, of course, this huge, huge institution in Bethesda, Maryland. And so I was enrolled in that trial, and I think I was 9, I believe. And what it involved was taking those same steroids, but also an IV medicine, which had been used kind of as a chemotherapy. And when you think of chemotherapy, you kind of think of cancer patients. And then it helps you realize what are the side effects. So it's super intense nausea and vomiting. When I talk about super intense nausea and vomiting, I'm talking about the fact that if I would go into a room where I had to have this treatment done, and I would actually just see the IV pole with the medicine bag hanging, that would just all of a sudden make me just nauseous, because it was an intense experience. And it didn't just cause nausea and vomiting, but it also caused hair loss. So even if I just wiped my hand, or every morning when I woke up, my pillow actually had my hair, which had fallen out. And also, actually, interestingly, some medications are meant to help you, but they also cause all these side effects. But my parents felt that they were actually doing the right thing. And like I said, it takes a lot of courage to kind of go against the system sometimes. And the medicine that I was on was cyclophosphamide, which is Cytoxan. So it's a very powerful medicine. And at that time, it was actually an experimental research drug. But as a result of the trial that I was in, that actually kind of became standard of care, meaning it was used all over for people who have lupus and kidney disease. So, as I said, it was in Maryland, and my parents actually drove me from Pennsylvania down to Maryland, and it was a good solid 2 hours. And, you know, I would stay at this hospital for a few days at a time for every single treatment. And it was difficult. It was definitely challenging, and it occurred throughout my youth, but I was able to persevere, and it's without... I couldn't have done this without my family and my friends and the support that I had. And I was able to graduate from high school. And actually, I was just at my graduation, and just after, I had to be hospitalized at NIH again because they wanted to do a kidney biopsy, which was that kind of that original kidney tissue that they did in the first place. And what they found is that they decided that I would be able to come off all those medicines because things had stabilized, meaning my lupus was more stable and in remission, if you hear that term. So, however, they said that, you know, your kidneys are damaged, but there is a medicine you can take, which happens to also treat high blood pressure, but this can help to protect whatever kidney tissue that you have left. So, you know, then these were kind of, I guess, the golden years, that after 1992, things were extremely stable. I was able to go to college, go to Yale. I did some research there. Afterwards, I actually helped to run a support group in New Haven, Connecticut. And then after that, I was kind of a lifelong graduate school student for a little bit. I went to Boston, became a Red Sox fan. I know I probably shouldn't say that here in New York, but I did. So at that time, they were the lucky losers. So. And then I actually, as a medical student, I was doing some research for I believe it was a paper. And I think maybe Google was available at that time, but whatever it was, I used the internet and I was just searching for lupus and Chinese. And so what I found was actually the Lupus Asian Network, which is Lantern. And I don't believe we have this large brochure here, but it's received a lot of praise on a national basis. And what we offer is a free telephone hotline for those who are interested in learning more about lupus, especially for the patients or their family members or even their friends. And we do things such as this to increase awareness of lupus. You may know about lupus, but you may not have known that lupus is an important Asian American health issue. And so actually we have a strong Lantern contingency kind of scattered throughout here, but mostly to my stage right. If some of you could stand up, there's Eliza, Roberta, and Karen. And I'm kind of pointing them out mostly because after this, I won't necessarily be around. So if you have additional questions, they can be picked on. And also Henrietta wears multiple hats. She's been up here earlier. You met her. And she's also on the advisory board for Lantern. So then, you know, I was still kind of in my golden years. I went to medical school at an osteopathic medical school in Maine. But at that time, I was just doing routine blood work, and it turns out that my platelets were low. And platelets are important because if they get really low, then you start to bleed. For example, if you knock into something, most people will probably just, you know, they're okay. But if your platelets are really low, you start to bruise very easily. The worst case scenario would be actually bleeding into the brain. So it was interesting, or not so interesting from my perspective, but after medical school, then you're a doctor, but you develop this, you're in this training program called residency. And it's very grueling because you work ridiculous hours, really. Some of the shifts are 24 hours straight, and it's not, you can't sleep in your own bed. You're actually sleeping in the hospital or being paged by whoever it is for whatever emergency or whatever patient in the hospital. And so during those golden years, everything was just fine. I was doing blood work. And then a few years ago, everything started to worsen because now those platelets being low is actually starting to bleed. So now when the platelets are low, it turns out for those who are the medical students, it was an ITP, which is an idiopathic thrombocytopenic purpura, or for whom that might be too complicated, it just means low platelets. And for me, it was really related to the lupus. And so, again, there's this huge gap where I really wasn't on any strong and terrible medicines, but I had to actually be placed back on these steroids and back on different immunosuppressants, and then gradually those were not working. And it actually got to the point where I needed additional IV medicines. And you know, during residency, it's a little, they really work you very hard. And so there are times where I would come off a 24-hour shift and go to the infusion center, have these IV medicines infused, and then you know, drive slowly back to home and crash on the floor or wherever it was. So it was not easy by any means. And it was, you know, I was at a point where I was a physician, and yet it turned the tables again. I was back to being a patient. So it all kind of came to a head in November of 06. That's actually my chest x-ray. But the platelets were so bad that I actually was bleeding from my nose, and blood was kind of coming, pulling out of my mouth. And I also started to have fevers that were really out of nowhere. And I had maybe a little bit of shortness of breath. And as it turns out, that those steroids again, that I had some side effects from that. And I was very ill in the hospital. I had a terrible pneumonia. And actually, at one point, I was in the intensive care unit. And thankfully, I recovered, of course, because I'm here today. But I went home. But then a month later, these are some real pictures of me. So again, like, what was happening was that the bleeding was out of control, because if you don't have enough platelets, your body does not have the ability to kind of stop the bleeding. So, you know, this thing was shoved up my nose to try to prevent the further bleeding while they gave me replacement platelets. For example, when you need a blood transfusion, you get blood back. So the same idea with platelets. If you need platelets, you get a platelet transfusion. So, you know, and then I had these bruises everywhere. So at this point, they really said, you know, I actually went to several specialists at Massachusetts General Hospital and also locally, and they really said, everybody said, you know, all the medical therapies have not worked, so you really need surgery. And so they removed my spleen, because the spleen is important with platelets. So as it turns out, if you remove the spleen, in many cases, the platelets come back to normal. And so that's indeed what happened. So several years ago now, I had my spleen removed, and then kind of back into the golden years, I guess you would say. So enough so that I was able to get married a little more than 3 years ago. And I finished that grueling training program in internal medicine residency at my hospital. And then I look very happy there, because that was my last 24-hour shift in that picture. And then just in a couple of short months, I'll have finished my training in infectious disease, and I'll be joining a private practice in the local area and hopefully teaching at the local school as well. So today I didn't want to overwhelm you with medical lingo, but I just wanted to at least introduce you a little bit more beyond what you already know, that you already at least heard about lupus. What you should take away is that it's a chronic disease, that life has its good and bad moments, and so does living with lupus.
She is a medical surgical nurse by trade, community organizer, cultural activist with a passion in Filipino ethnic cultural arts. She also co-authored publications on community health workers' experiences and on cardiovascular disease of the Filipino focus group. And she's also on a number of board of directors related to the Asian American health issue.
Good morning, everyone. How are you today? I saw that not much of you went out during the break time, or what was it, the break time? So can I allow you, or would you permit me to let you stand a little bit, stretch your knees. Stretch our knees, stretch our shoulder. Don't be shy, this is part of my panel. Deep breath. And now we can sit down. We're talking so much about health, so we might as well internalize what we're doing. Now, I'd rather dance my speech today rather than read a slideshow. However, this is not the call of the setting. So, in other words, I'm not really an OBGYN. This is not my academic specialty. to talk to you about menopause. But as a community health worker, perhaps I'll bring to you my personal experience, and also whatever I have read and my other interactions with the community. So, if it's not very incriminating, can I ask how many of us had menarche at 13? Menarche. Oh. If we are women, this is the English word when menstruation started. How many of us started our menstruation at 13 years old? Don't be shy. Raise your hand. Oh, no. At 14. At 15. At 10 years old. Okay, I see that there's so much shyness for us to reveal about menstruation, how we started menstruating. Of course, men will like giggle a little bit, but guys, you have never been in this world without your mother have a first menstruation. So we have to...
Some started before 10.
Oh, okay. How about 9 years old menarche? Oh, I didn't count down the numbers, actually. So I just want to start it from there. Before menarche, we have a whisper, hey, you know, this is kind of secret or something that we are so uncomfortable or something very excited to look forward to have that first drop of blood in our panties. Now, I might as well be very clinical and very frank in this discussion because we are getting into the end of that menarche, which is menopause. Another very uncomfortable topic. And I didn't really want to discuss this with you. Do you think how much uncomfortable I am asking you when was the first drop of your blood in your panty? No. But, as I said, you want me to rather dance it? Ah, well. Okay, so, the world menopause and the world menarche is the extreme in a woman's body, in a woman's life. Something that we don't usually bring up in a coffee table or in parties. We don't talk about it. Hey, when is your menopause? Or when was your first menstruation started? You don't do that as a conversational topic. Today, we have to face this. And we have to be proud that we have this cycle of life as women. And there's a universal take on this. What is menopause? What is this among Asians? And what is this among other tribe, other nations? So I'm tasked to talk about Asian women menopause and, you know, how much shades of Asians we are. From the Far East to the biggest Desi community, to the Chinese, to the Japanese. So we'll round it up. In one of the studies that I have read and some of the studies that I pick up some of my informations. Now, I'm supposed to use this, right? Menopause. Gone. No more monthly cycle. No more period. No more comma, in fact. Only exclamation point. Gone. Hey, I will not buy pads anymore until you become incontinent anyway. No more tampons. I never had any orientation. What is that? I only come to you, know it in the magazines, and now in US, in teenagers wear tampons. I don't understand how it is. So, for men, listen very well. You have your mothers, your sisters, your girlfriends, and along the way in this life, you are partners with women. So, what is menopause to Asians? It is varied, multifaceted, multidimensional reality. All right, let me see how it is perceived and responded. It just showed that I don't really know how to make slides. I have to show my kids, hey, help me! And said, like, give me some sleep. Anyway, how is menopause perceived and responded, as I said, it depends on your culture and your AIDS or your views on aging and your sexuality. Oh, what happened to the photos? Okay, so that could have been a nice photo, but anyhow, how many of you experience hot flashes? All right, there's some honest young women like me. Now, hot flashes is like common in the market or somewhere, like I saw somewhere in the TV something like, I don't know what, I don't have TV at home, so I was passing my patient's room and I'm giving medication. I saw that, oh, I have hot flashes, and they're in a camel. And so the other woman behind her said, you're in the middle of the desert. So you can you see that, right? So hot flashes is an English word. It's I only met this time here, I mean, in according to the books I've read, but I never heard hot flashes among my old folks. So that means there's no hot flashes experienced by my elders. Or according to the study, not much among Asian women. This word hot flashes doesn't exist in Ibongo or maybe in even Chinese dialects, Chinese languages, or not at all in Filipino. Oh, in the Philippines, it's normal to have hot flashes, though. You have to have a fan all the time. You don't have to have menopause there. So, it goes with how old you started your menstruation or your menarche, that's genetics, and lifestyle, culture, and other factors undefined, which probably, it's still up to the present moment, there are more still debates. According to the literature I've read, there's always contrasting theories about it. So I might as well put it other factors yet undefined, because for me, menopause is part of the life cycle. Like, you had your menstruation, you're born, your breast started growing, you had your menstruation, then you have all this monthly period, not comma, not exclamation point. And lucky enough that these AIDS have already disposable napkins. When I was growing, at grade 4, we were taught how to make napkins, sanitary napkins. And when I bring this up to young people, they're like, yo, what is that? So that is how how life cycle is being dealt with. Now, it's not organic anymore. You have to go to Duane Reade or CVS to buy that and throw it away and add more killing of the mountains, I mean, trees. So, and giving birth is a normal process. Like, I delivered, when I was young, I delivered a 17-year-old. I was not yet a nurse when I delivered that 17-year-old in like 175 kilometers away from the first health center. So I delivered that baby using, what do you call this, banana leaf. You know the banana leaf, the part that is sterile. I mean, that is my analysis when I became a nurse. You put it under the butt of the woman who's giving birth, and you catch the baby with the same thing, with that banana leaf. And also the stalk of the banana leaf, you cut that and remove the upper part. So that is sterile. You put that under the coccyx where the woman pushes, and here comes the baby, beautiful crying baby. And all the rest of that indigenous organic process of giving birth at home. But when I became a nurse, I will not go to these houses anymore and give birth because I was afraid already. So that kind of disparity between my Western learning and my indigenous learning, so much so with this topic of menopausal, like see, there's so much fear when you say, oh, I'm going to menopause at 45 or what, and all this, I'm afraid of hot flashes and everything. I only heard that in the international, in my international integration. I never heard about this fear and fear of decline of femininity, allure, you don't have your menstruation anymore, you're less than a woman. Where are you? I don't know. back home, that is like the stereotype of the Western youth-oriented society, that youth is measured according to how you can produce children and how can you become sexy on the road. So there's so much fear to accept the reality of the cycle of life. Now, in contrast, Asian women living in a culture, I mean, my experience, we venerate older women. They are the source of wisdom. They're the manangs. And this, every cycle of life is being welcomed with sanctity. In fact, there are rituals. There are rituals for becoming a woman, birthing rituals, and rituals on how the older women are being respected and venerated for the years that they have experienced. And that experience is a book by itself, learned by the community through oral tradition. And of course, there's no more washing of that napkin in the river, or no more running to the CVS or Duane Reade. You know how uncomfortable this topic is, but you see how proud I am to talk about this. I usually just dance this in poetry. So, and these are coming from some studies where, why is it that among Western women, the menopause is treated like a sickness, you know? Like menstruation is taken as a sickness. It's not a sickness. This is a normal process of life, venerating the beauty and the productivity of a woman, that after her menstruating days, her productivity doesn't stop her baby producing factory effect as a person. So, and the prevalence of all this epidemiological study, I'm not really comfortable citing it, but I have to cite it just to have some evidence based on what I'm talking about. Because as much as evidence based, I can say on the Asian point of view is experiential, but on the Western side of being a woman, I have to extract it from all these scientific studies. So, according to this study, the more privilege a woman has, the more she's able to think about the problems of menopausal, and she will experience the hot flushes. And in these comparative studies, it is said that among the farmers, it's actually a study among, it's the work of a Singaporean OBGYN I'm citing right now. It says that in the Singaporean study, 7% of women were significantly bothered by any of the symptoms of menopause. Only 7%. My slides are jumping. It's okay. And anyway, this is about hot flushes. Like 10 to 20% Asian women are affected with hot flushes. Meanwhile, the Western women are 30 to 50%. Now, there is a study of old. This is this one, which is a study of women held across nation, and which this is the source of the evidence base that I'm saying. I mean the study. So there is actually an international conference on International Menopause Conference, or organization, International Conference of Menopause. Did you hear about that? No? I was so surprised, though. When I was gathering literature, I said, what? It's really a big thing. There's an United Nations seat on just discussing menopause. I know. I'll gather questions from you today. How? I know why. Anyway, so let me go. And it says, within the Asian population, there's a diverse range of experiences Indians are more likely to experience menopausal symptoms than are Chinese. Even among the East Asian, Chinese women appear to be more symptomatic than the Japanese. Later on, you'll see who is the most tofu-eating population. I think they're both. Because in another study says, Japanese women who eats tofu a lot has less symptomatic experience on menopausal. But it's just the same thing. Chinese too eat tofu a lot. So I don't know what study. That. Oh, I'm just repeating here, like how Asian women experiences more hot flashes than Western women. And it talks also about pain and joint pains and osteoporosis. It's if the clinical part of this is if your estrogen is low, then you will have to develop more the tendency of having osteoporosis. So that's another lot more of study or discussion that we have to look into. Now, it cites also, this study cites also that in fibroid women, their menopausal symptoms are trivial concern. I mean, if you are thinking more of finding food, I think you don't have to focus more on your hot flashes, if there's any. So, I think all these are kind of theory that if I'll read to you will bore you more rather than experiential that I have to extract from you. Because these are why I took the Singaporean study, because as a Filipino, in a way, our set is kind of comparative to the Singaporean. There is no Filipino study in menopausal. As far as Google says. There is interclimacteric study which mention hot flashes and menopause, which is very, very minor in that particular study. So there's not much focus on menopause in a way, because we look at it not as a problem but as part of a venerated cycle of life. So I'm going to stop my story here. We'll ask more questions. And all the pictures that you can laugh more do not appear. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Poetry. Our very last speaker is Lois Chin Lee. She's currently the director of the Chinese American Planning Council, Queens School Age Daycare Center at Public School 20 in downtown Flushing. Lois actually has a very long list of community service volunteer work that include Chao Bi Wang's Women's Health Advisory Committee and Kami Lee Leukemia Foundation. And I think I'm going to sum up in one sentence about Lois. She views her professional work as a labor of love, and is grateful for the gift of time to see the fruits of her labor.
I only have 6 slides, so it's very short, but I'm including my life story. It's not in the slides, it's just factual. And then some statistics are not in the slides because I want you to pay attention and take notes. So anyhow, when I was asked to speak about this, this whole panel is supposed to be speaking about your women's journey, right? And so it's your lifespan. And this lifespan for osteoporosis starts from my experience from childhood to my senior moment. So all of you 4 in between childhood and seniors. So hopefully this discussion will apply to your own life as well as your profession in healthcare. Okay, so then the first slide I'm going to talk about is the risk factors. Okay, so when you look at this, let's see now. I'm Asian, and that can't be changed. So a female, I don't want to change that. Okay, so that's not changeable. 50 years and above, that's me. I'm in that risk category. Low body weight and thin, small bone frame. That's me too. Menopause. I had early menopause at 45. History of fracture as an adult. Yes, I broke my leg. So I'm really in this whole risk factors. So up to here, is the things that you cannot change. So if you fall in this category, we're not in good shape. And then below here is the factors that you can change. Now, I'm going to give you a little bit of our history and some statistics now. Okay, so research shows that Asian American women there's a lot of research on this topic, between the ages of 20 to 70, it showed that the bone density, so they're looking at your bones and where your calcium is stored, the bone density of Asian women over 50 is significantly lower than any other group. And we have a high incidence of osteoporosis. We're the highest, the Asian women, nationally. So for the National Osteoporosis Foundation, they reported that 20% of Asian women may have symptoms, may have osteoporosis, compared to 10% non-Asian and 5% black. So if you're African-American, most likely you're not going to have osteoporosis. Okay, now, so what can we do to prevent all this from happening? We're looking at long-term calcium intake. So this is my story. When I was little, as a child, I went to elementary school down in Chinatown, and I was really skinny, and I didn't speak much English. In fact, when I graduated elementary school, I was 45 pounds. And in the 1950s, we had to bring money to buy snacks. It was some milk and cookies time. So a penny would buy you a pretzel stick or those chocolate graham crackers. Oh, some people remember that. You had to bring money to school. But anyhow, because I was so shy and so quiet, I didn't speak much, and people kept stealing my money that was left on the table. So I never had milk and cookies. Then later on, during parent-teacher conferences, they would ask my father, you know, your daughter's pretty much like deaf and dumb. She doesn't speak, you know. You don't bring her lunch, snack money. What's going on with your family? And then he said, I gave her a quarter every day. But they didn't realize people were stealing my money. So I didn't have much milk and cookies. So that was that. Then when I finished high school, I was 74 pounds. And then when I finished college, I was 88 pounds. So you can see that my parents didn't know much about calcium intake, didn't know anything about nutrition at all. And I remember when my mom got married very young, and she was only maybe 15 or 16 years old, and then when I was born, she was only 18. And she came to the United States, and she didn't know how to cook. And so, but my father was a very good cook, so she would have to wait for him to come home from work, and then we would be sitting here looking at the chicken that he had put, you know, jump the guy means that, you know, like you poach the chicken. And then she didn't know how to cut the chicken, so the whole chicken, so we would have to wait. So really, nutrition was not too good. Anyhow, what happened later on was that, I have a better story later, but so because my parents didn't know much about calcium and nutrition, now we find that it's very common among Asian families. Many, in fact, the percentage, 90% of Asian women are either lactose intolerant, or they cannot digest dairy products easily, or they simply dislike dairy products. So now you think about your own family. Oh my! Did we eat much cheese? Let's see, in China, we didn't have a cow, so we didn't have much milk, you know, so it was a lot of vegetables. So anyhow, I think there's a whole aversion to dairy products, okay? So what happened was now, I'm married at age 30, and I'm pregnant at age 32. So never have children right away. You have to get to know your spouse. And so, you know, get used to married life. Anyhow, so finally at age 32, my OBSGYN said that if I don't gain weight, because I was having problems gaining weight. So in the first trimester, I only gained 1 pound. And so she said, listen, if you don't gain any weight, then I'm going to hospitalize you and feed you intravenously. And so I said, oh, wow. That was my epiphany moment. I better gain some weight. So I had to eat, and I was not one of those diet conscious people. You know, I was just naturally skinny, right? So then I realized I had to eat for two people now, right? Me and the baby, right? And so I had to take care of someone else other than myself. So I started to drink milkshakes daily. And I actually like milkshakes to this day. And then I gained 25 pounds, my whole birth weight. Now, people tell you stories that, oh, when I was pregnant, I gained 50 pounds, 75. It didn't happen to me. I maximized at 25. I couldn't gain any more weight. So I gained 25 pounds, and guess what? I wanted to keep the weight after I gave birth, you know, right? Because I wanted to stay healthy because I was going to breastfeed. So I did keep the weight. I'm about 125 now. And then So when my daughter was born, I said, well, you know, I really have to continue this this calcium routine here. So I continue to drink 3 glasses of milk or some kind of dairy products, you know, ice cream or yogurt or whatever, to help with my breastfeeding of my 2 daughters. Now, a lot of people, when they saw my children at such a very young age, when they were like the infant toddler stage, they always commented, wow, your children really has very strong neck bones. They can lift up their head when they were like 1 month. And they started to walk before the age of 1. And that's like really amazing. And I said, wow. So, because I had to catch up to that calcium intake. What happens is that, okay, go to the next slide. When you, I want to explain what is osteoporosis. And I'm going to tell you the whole story about how to keep up your calcium intake. Because I'm sure like 100% of the people in this room do not keep up with your calcium intake. So I'm going to tell you the short and simple way how to do it. Okay, so what is osteoporosis and what is its effect? It's a disease which causes your bones to be very porous. It's less dense and it's very fragile. So it's brittle and prone to break. So you hear a lot of stories about people who have hip fractures and things like that because of osteoporosis. There's no real symptoms until you actually have your first fall, you know, first fracture, and that may be a sign of osteoporosis. And then the fractures always occurs often in the hips, your spine, and your wrist. And if you have spinal injuries or spinal fracture, then the effects is that it can limit your mobility. You see a lot of people with osteoporosis, they're sort of very hunched over, you know, their back, and it's probably because they had a spinal injury. They didn't realize they had a small fracture, or stress fracture, or some kind of fracture. And then they have that stoop posture, and they have chronic pain. So this is what osteoporosis is. Now, I think Rebecca had asked me to do this talk because she knew that I broke my leg. So now, how did that happen? I was at Madison Square Garden with my students, and we were watching the circus. And then some stranger asked me to take a picture, some tourist, of her family. So I did. So my class is way up there, and now I have to run and catch up to them. And then in running, I didn't see that there was a dip in the floor. So I ran, and then I sort of hit that dip, and then I flipped, and then I hit the floor. So I hit the ground running. That's what happened to me. So, and then I broke my femur bone. The femur bone is the largest bone in your thigh area. So it's really strong. And so how did you break your femur bone? So I was rushed over to NYU Hospital, and then they examined the bone, and they said, you have a healthy bone. It wasn't because of osteoporosis. It really had to do with the momentum of your running fast, the impact of how hard you hit the floor. So that was good news for me, all right? Now I'm going to teach you about building strong bones. You build strong bones before the age of 20. So you really, see, remember, I didn't have that advantage. I didn't have my milk and cookies. But now you have to tell your children or young people that you may be working with that they have to really build up their calcium intake and so it can be stored in your bones before the age of 20. And that's the best defense against osteoporosis. They even found a study that there was a study of 20 and 30-year-old Korean women, and they found that even these young women, they had signs of osteoporosis, you know. How you find out is through a test. I'll tell you about the test later. Okay, so what happens with these young women, they find that people is excessive dieting. You're so concerned about your image and to stay skinny and all of this, so you're not careful. You know, you're not eating your ice cream or something like that. And so this excessive dieting causes hormonal imbalance of estrogen, and it upsets their menstrual cycle, and that's why you need your estrogen. So then by the age of 30, that is your peak bone mass. So if you're 30 years old, this is pretty much you're at your peak now, and now you're going to start to lose bone, and then it really accelerates losing, especially after menopause. So now all that calcium that you've been storing is being used up. So now it's important to stop the bone loss with adequate calcium intake. Now the calcium intake. You need to have a certain amount of calcium. If you're an adult, 20 to 50 years old, you need about 1,000 milligrams. If you're an adult 50 and above, you need 1,200 milligrams of calcium every day. But if you're a teenager, you need about 1,300 milligrams. Now, why do teenagers need more than any other age group? Has to do with their optimal growth spurts is at those teenage years. For guys and girls, this is your spurt. So you want optimal development of your general health and your bones too. So they need a little bit more. So now we're looking at examples of food with high calcium. Almonds, all your dark green vegetables, asparagus, bok choy, broccoli, mustard green, Napa cabbage. If you go down Chinatown, you see all those vegetable stands by everything that's green. And saute with garlic and ginger, and that's it. And that's it. You know, it's so simple to cook with dark leafy vegetables. Even though it's an unusual vegetable, what is a water spinach? What is bitter melon? All those unusual vegetables, eat it. It really comes out good because I did a workshop for 25 Chinese vegetables in the American diet because most people don't know what to do with it. But when you taste it, the natural sweetness of the vegetables is really good. So then, of course, your fish, your salmon, oysters, all your beans and your legumes, your sesame seeds, soybeans, tofu. Now, tofu, they say, oh, wow, that's really good. But there are different types of tofu. And it has to do with firm tofu and soft tofu. I'm going to tell you a little bit in a minute. All your milk and dairy products, milk, yogurt, cheese, ice cream. And then your calcium-fortified orange juice. If you see any calcium-fortified cereals, calcium-fortified bread, calcium-fortified, rice, buy it. Okay, and all your fruits and vegetables, they really have some degree of calcium. Now, the problem is your body can only absorb about 500 milligrams of calcium at a time. So you can't take like two calcium pills and that'll be it for the whole day. It won't absorb. You just wasted all that calcium because it's not being absorbed in your body. So this is how you do it. And this is what I do every single day. Okay, so if you were to try to figure out how much calcium do you take a day, you should write down all the foods that you eat in a day. And then there's these charts. You go to Google and then you search, something with calcium and high calcium content or foods with calcium rich and things like that. Okay, so if you have for breakfast a glass of low-fat milk, that's already 300 milligrams of calcium. If you take that with cereal, you'll be up to 500 milligrams. That's it. You did it. So that's once. You only need to do it three times a day. If you're in this range, you only need to do it twice a day. Okay, so I had my calcium intake in the morning, so I'm doing good. And now for the afternoon, maybe I want to eat yogurt, okay? Yogurt and some fruit. That's already 415 milligrams. So that's pretty good, too. And then by the time you get to dinner, if you have your vegetables or your fruit, see, vegetables are a little bit tricky because it's only like 10, 20, 30 grams of calcium. So if you're eating I do have the figures. Because strawberries is 25 milligrams of calcium. Okay, celery is 41 milligrams. Asparagus, 21. Eggplant, 34. Cauliflower is only 10 because it's not a dark green vegetable, right? But then if you, for lunch, if you eat a whole slice of pizza, that did it for you. Okay, that's 500 to 873 milligrams of calcium. It's because some people eat more than one slice of pizza, you know. So it just depends. Pasta has about 85, eggs about 55, broccoli 20%, 21. And then tofu. If you buy soft tofu, it's only 138 milligrams. But if you buy firm tofu, it's 204 milligrams. So then you're better off buying firm than soft. And especially when you cook, you want to use firm for soups, for pan frying, sauteing. It's better to do firm. Okay, I don't even know why people use soft, because it falls apart, unless it's Mapo tofu. Okay, so anyhow, figure out what kind of tofu you want, right? String beans is like 50. Bananas and apples is 8 to 10 milligrams, not too much, you know. Avocados is about 18. So anyhow, you figure out your calcium intake. So now we know for sure that you can all do it. And calcium fortified orange juice has between 200 and 260 milligrams. So it depends on, you have a 6-ounce cup or an 8-ounce cup. So if you drink orange juice, that's pretty good, you know, because I didn't want to drink milk in the morning, but I want to drink my orange juice. Then you're going to get your intake. Now, calcium we know that it helps strong bones and teeth. It prevents blood clots and manages your high blood pressure, all sorts of things like that. Okay, next. Now, the trick about calcium, in order for it to be absorbed, is that you need vitamin D. It's just having a calcium a supplement is not enough, okay? So you need this vitamin D to help absorb the calcium. And so if you want to, the best way to do it is to go outside for a walk every day during your lunch period. So you can't sit at your desk all day long, right? So even I'm the director of my own center, and I tell my staff, for our lunchtime right now, when we go out to lunch, you stand outside for 15 minutes. That's it. And that is enough to absorb the right amount of calcium, to absorb the calcium in your body. You need vitamin D. So go outside for 15 minutes, okay? Otherwise, you have to eat an egg yolk, salt fish water, fortified dairy products, vitamins and mineral supplements to get that vitamin D, okay? So we have to make sure you do it. Okay, so now besides that, for osteoporosis, the other thing is exercise, okay? Now, you need a weight-bearing exercise. So walking, see, your weight is all, is weight-bearing, right? Jogging, climbing stairs, dancing, weight training, lifting weights. That all can strengthen your bones. But the other kinds of exercises that's equally important is like Tai Chi, bike riding, swimming, because you need to increase the flexibility and to improve your balance to prevent falling. I don't know about you, but sometimes people are like really clumsy. You see really clumsy people, they walk and they're bumping into here and they're falling down here because they should have been taking Tai Chi so they can, have better balance. It's all in balance. After I broke my leg and I've been following my eating regimen and my exercise regimen, I don't fall, that often. And when I trip on the, New York City sidewalks are not so good, right? So then you fall, trip on a crack, I'm able to, balance and not fall and hit the ground again, So try to find some way to balance yourself. Okay, no smoking and keeping your drinking to moderation. Now, this is really important because there's no real symptoms and you don't want to break your bone and find out, did I have osteoporosis or not? It's better to get tested. So the bone mineral density test, the BMD, and it's also the dual energy X-ray, whatever, DXA. Okay, take that test. It's really very mild. It's painless. It's an X-ray. So I do that every 2 years to see if, how I'm doing. So since I passed 60 recently, my doctor prescribed medication for me, and that's treatment now. Okay, last slide. Okay, so treatment to really, remember I already talked about you get doing your exercises so you can have better balance and all this. Okay, but really it's the calcium supplements. Now, the calcium that you get in food and the calcium supplements are the same type of calcium. So it doesn't matter how you get your calcium. If you want to take a Tums, that's a calcium carbonate, and then a calcium citrate, whatever. Make sure or they even have those little chocolate squares, Vicative, but you have to get the Vicative with the vitamin D. And then when you buy the orange juice, remember it's calcium and vitamin D. So, or else go outside and stand outside for 15 minutes, right? And then they get the sun in. But the thing with the sun, if you shower, then you wash it off. No. They just say that really you should go outside, because of whatever. You're not going to get skin cancer for standing outside for 15 minutes. So there's no real cure for osteoporosis. And there's some medication. So after I passed 60, the doctors start looking that I was losing bone. And it's really just because you're aging. So now I'm on medication, I'm on Fosamax, and that's to help, that it stops the bone loss, But you have to really go on medication, you have to talk to your doctors about it, okay? So, it stops further bone loss and reduces the risk of fractures if you want to be on medication. So that's pretty much my story. And then on the way in, I was driving to work, and then I saw one of my neighbors, and she's only 23 years old, and I said, "Hey, you want to ride to the subway?" And she said, "Yes." And I said, "Okay, since you're sitting with me, I'm going to do my whole speech for you," and I did the whole thing without looking at slides. And then I said to her, "Now, do you have a normal calcium intake?" And she said, "No. Since college, she stopped drinking milk. When she was little, she did." And she said, "Now she realizes that." Before she reaches her peak at age 30, she better start taking more calcium, you know, and start drinking your milk, people, you know. That's it. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Lois. So we have listened to presentation that interviewing personal stories with health condition that experienced as an Asian woman through lupus, osteoporosis, and menopause. So I'm going to open up the floor to any questions to us speakers, Cindy, Poetry, and Lois.
Yeah, they have to. Well, the Chinese vegetables will do it, you know, because all your green leafy vegetables is high in calcium too. But if they can just have, they can take pills for, you know, people who are lactose intolerant, but it's in other foods they can find. So a calcium pill is 500 milligrams, one pill or two pills a day, that would do it. You know, have three tums a day, you know, it doesn't hurt, you know. Better to look at, you know, you have to go ask your doctors. So even lactose intolerant is no excuse, because you can get calcium in some other forms.
Okay. Yeah, soy milk.
And soy milk too. So, but it's for men and women, because this conference was Asian American women. But men, you are needing calcium in your bones too. And then for the exercise portion, there were some statistics, 42% of Asian women do not engage in any type of physical exercise. So you're in the 90% category of not having enough, of not liking milk, and then you're in the 42% category, and then there's another statistic about 60% of Asian women, something, I have to go look it up. We're not doing too good. 65% of Asian women have low bone density. So, you know, it's really a serious problem.
The question dealt with if there's any misdiagnosis with lupus. For example, if it's early on where someone might just have arthritis. And I would say, you know, anything is possible. The trickiness of lupus is that there are lots of different criteria, and you actually don't need to have those all at the same time. They could be at different moments in time. So would it be possible that someone had some joint pain and then maybe years down the line, they had other manifestations? It would be completely possible. Sometimes it takes the right mix of scientific deduction, some luck, honestly, sometimes. But I have the faith that sometimes a diagnosis takes a while, but it's the complete mystery of lupus. And for the medical students, it's a disease that if you know very well, it's a good one to know. So just for the complexities of everything.
I don't want to keep everyone away from your lunch. So I am very inspired by the presentations today at this panel. So would please just give our speakers a round of applause, please.